position sequence, you can dictate different characteristics of what is shown. So for our purpose, we don't want to turn the display on at all, so we're not sending it a 0F, we wanted to shut it off while we're getting it initialized. So we're sending it a value of 0.8 in hex, and that will shut it off. And so now the next step, the next programming step in the sequence for initializing is a value of 0.1. And so what the 0.1 value does is it clears the display. So that's just straightforward. That's a value of hex 0.1. So we're clearing it. Then after we've cleared it and gotten rid of any residual data that was on the bus, by possibly if you were running it before, you're just making sure that it's been cleared. Anyhow, so then the next step of the sequence that we have is 0C. And 0C hex value essentially turns the display on and initializes it with turning the display on. And if we were to send it the value 0E, for example, you would turn the display on, you would turn the cursor on, and have the blinking off. So there's different combinations that you can have. Like we had here, we had it at 0F, which actually turned everything on. So just remember that. But for our step, we're sending it a value of 0C. Now the last step in our initialization sequence is a value of 0.6, and what that does is it sets the mode, the write mode, for the display and how the information that we're going to be sending to it, the character information on the data bus, how it's going to interpret that and what it will do with it. And so that's this last step within the initialization sequence. And so with a value of 0.6, we're initializing the LCD to automatically increment the address for the display, so it's going to automatically do that for us for every character that we send it, and it's also going to move the cursor to the right, so essentially every letter that we put on, when we go to send it another one, it's going to push the other cursor to the right so that it won't overwrite over top of the character that we just sent it. So that's what this 0.6 hexadecimal value is for. And so that being the last step in our initialization sequence, you'll notice how all of a sudden our RS line, or our register select, switches from a logic low to a logic high. And what that does is it dictates to the LCD display that we're now going to be sending it information on the data bus as character data. So it's no longer commands, it's information to display on the screen. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to bring in the chart that I have, and I've displayed the hexadecimal equivalent of the upper and lower 4 bits to explain it, just so you can get a little bit of a better picture on how it works. So, for instance, we have all this information here because we're in the logic high on our RS value. With every falling edge on the enable line, that's essentially sending a specific character to the screen. And because the way we have it initialized, every the falling edge of the next cycle, it'll automatically push the character that we sent to it to the right and allow us to essentially display a message on the screen. So now you can see it here where our RS line is in a high state all the way through here, all the way down until the end of this data bus value, hex value of 20, so two falling edge cycles. And so what that means is that this entire sequence here is character data. And essentially what this is doing, all of this hex value data on the data bus is essentially displaying the word Bluetooth link on the screen. And so now, essentially how that works is we have, so every falling edge on the enable line, it's essentially writing a character. And so if you can see that here, the hex value 42, that corresponds to the capital letter B. And we have 6C, that corresponds to the letter L, and so on and so forth. And then you can see here how we have two values of 6F. Well, if you can see it there, that's because we have two lowercase letter O within the word Bluetooth. So that's those two values here. And then we have 74, 68, 20, 4C, 69, 6E, and that essentially is writing the rest of the first line. Now you can notice here how in between Bluetooth and link, we have a blank space here. Well, that's the value 20. So 20 is your essentially a blank space between words. So you have 20 here, but, you know, which is the space between Bluetooth and link. And then we have the last two characters on the line here after link, which dictates the end of the first line. And so now, you'll notice too that the control signal switches from, the RS line switches from a logic high to a logic low, and then we're essentially writing a value, which is a control signal, to the LCD display to give it some instruction on what to do next. And so essentially what we're doing is we're telling it to move with the value CO on the data bus, but as a command to the LCD display, not character data. When it's in a logic high state, the RS value is a logic low. That's instructing the LCD with a command on what to, how to interpret the information on the data bus if it's receiving it. And so what we're doing is we're instructing it with a value of C0. And a C0, if I'm going to bring this in here, this little chart here that I have, C0 is a set DRAM address. And what that is that places the cursor at the start of the second line. So essentially what we're doing is we're telling the cursor to carriage down to the second line, to the beginning of the second line. So that's what this CO hex value does when we're sending it, when the RS value is in a logic low. and then you can see here, you're probably getting a clear picture of what's going on here. And I'll switch over here 1 second. So there's a little bit more of a zoomed out image there. I'll just zoom in here a little bit so you can see. And so, bringing this back in here again, pardon me and get my images mixed up here. So with the message Bluetooth link connected, and then again with our control signal here, the CO, which is a command telling it to bring the cursor or moving the cursor down to the beginning of the second line so that it starts at the beginning here. Then we alternate again from a the control line being our RF line. It switches again from a logic low to a logic high state, and then we have the value 7E being on the data bus, a hex value of 7E, and that is this character here, which is a little arrow. And then it proceeds through the rest and all the way through, and you'll notice here how 20, remember how I indicated that 20 was our blank space? Well, we have several, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 blank spaces on the bottom line, and then if we count our enable falling edges here, when it's on the hex value of 20, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 falling edges with a hex value of 20, which corresponds to our 6 blank spaces here on the bottom of the screen. Then you'll notice where we switch again from our RS value, our RS line here, switches from, once again, it switches from a logic high, which is being a representation of character data on the data bus, is being interpreted as character data. We switch to a logic low, which then, again, it becomes a command sequence. So then it reads the data on the data bus and interprets that as a command function. And so the command function of hex value 80 on our little text document here that I created, the hex value, I'll put it up here just so we can see it a little better. And so here we go, we have the hex value of 80. That's telling it it's a set DDRAM address, and what it's doing is it's placing the cursor at the start of the first line. So now that is interpreted to essentially bring our cursor back to the beginning of the line, right here at the start, where capital B is. And then you'll notice again, all of a sudden it switches from that logic low on the RS value to a logic high, so all of a sudden we're back into the mode of sending character data to the display. And so it, all of a sudden you see 4, 2, 6C, 7, 5, 6, 5, 7, 4, 6, F. Now, if you recall, that is the same value, so 42, 6C, 7, 5. If we scroll back here, you'll notice it here. Here we go, 42, 6C, 7, 5. So essentially what it's doing is it's looping. So it's gone through that sequence, and it's just going to continuously loop. The code is going to continuously loop, constantly displaying this message on the screen over and over again. And now what that means is that it's essentially monitoring the data bus here. And so if we were to actually go in there, if we could go in somehow and manipulate our signal lines or variables, if you will, that are holding the information for specific characters when our RS value is high, if we could manipulate these at different points, we would essentially be able to change the characters that are being on the screen. And so essentially that's exactly what I've done. Is what I've done is I've gone and the signal lines or variables that I have set up that dictate which hexadecimal value is here is essentially dictated by either a string value that we can write in within our VHDL code, or also what you can do is have it so that a specific set of switches that you have on your DDQ board, for instance, if you have an 8-bit, say for instance the first 8 bits of switches, you could essentially dictate which hexadecimal value is on the data bus at a particular time. And so you could essentially control what letter is being driven onto the screen at a specific time. And so we're going to go through that, and when we're actually looking at the VHDL code, you'll understand and you'll see how it all works. And so I'll bring in this this chart here that I've created just so you can see it a little better. And I've got the upper and lower bits, and for different hex values that are shown, you can interpret them and find them on this grid here. And this is the chart that's available within the data sheets that you can go and check out. So for instance, for the value, if we go to the beginning of our sequence, so I'll go back to the first page that we had, where it shows the beginning of the initialization. So for instance, the value 42, when it's in the RS value is in a logic high, so that is character data being sent. So the hex value 42, let's look at what that is. So we start with the upper 4-bit, so we got 4 here, and then 2. So we go down to 2 here, and we go and we meet where they meet, the two lines meet, the upper and lower. You notice how it's a capital B character, and that's exactly what that value has displayed on the screen. So you see how that relates to the chart that we have here, which is available in the data sheet for the HD44780 LCD. And so you just essentially go and you map out which characters you want to have displayed, and you assign that specific hexadecimal value within the VHDL code, and that will dictate which character is being displayed. And so eventually what you can do is there's areas of memory within the RAM that you can send your own character data and pixel information so you can create your own graphics or your own custom characters. And that'll be a future instructional video that I'll put together to show you how to do that. So anyhow, that's pretty much how the signals are interpreted. And so again, remember that this is a true scan off the logic analyzer. So now we're going to go and we'll check out the VHDL code that I wrote to create this specific sequence, initialization sequence, and the character data. So we'll go and look at the VHDL code and we'll compare it to this waveform so that you can understand how the code works and how it creates these specific signals.
Okay, hold up. Ubuntu is hooked up, and we've got this USB to RC32 adapter that I've got, and that's going to be on the hooked up to Ubuntu and the box. And Ubuntu is booting up here. Should be able to get the 2D scan from the SICK LMS200. Going to ROS and using a special, it's actually a SICK LMS plugin that was online. Whoops, you got to see my password. Okay, so now we're going to configure the SICK LMS driver to work with the USB unit and set the baud rate for the RS-232 port. So we got to set the parameters. Okay, and this should show us the 2D image data streaming from the LMS200. And there we go, it's already set up. And so there's our 2D data coming in. So I close this, pardon me. And you can rotate it around to see the different perspectives of it. And I'll move in front of the laser here just so you can see. So that red spot is me on that chair. Moving around in front of the laser. To the now I'm out of range, now I'm not being beamed, and along into the walls and whatnot with the lasers coming and hitting and bouncing off. And so anyways, eventually it's strictly a 2D, it's only viewing one stream right now, so the goal is to actually have the laser rotate at different angles and then plotting those in a 3D environment and plotting it and essentially creating a 3D point cloud rendering. So that's what I'm going to be working on next. Thanks for watching. So, as being a hobbyist, we usually have to resort to buying really old gear. So I managed to get this old robot control system. It's a company called CIS, actually a Canadian company in Burlington, and it's called CIS Robotics. I think now they're actually called Thermo Fisher Scientific, and they do a lot of medical-related testing robots and automation. And anyway, this was one of the early systems from the 80s, mid-80s, and anyway, I managed to learn about them and purchased a control module. This unit here is called the SRS M1A, and communicates through serial and some DOS software, and has some driver cards, the main motherboard there, power supply, it's got a peach pendant, which I'm still trying to repair. It took me quite a while, actually. I held on to this controller for about 5 years before I actually managed to get a matching robot. I waited trying to find the actual SRS M1A robot, but they just ceased to show up on eBay. And so what I ended up doing was finding this one, which is the upgraded model from the SRS M1A, and this is called an SRS Plus A250. And there was an A150, but this one they're still all pretty similar, except there's some minor changes and some voltage levels a little different, some revisions, and then they have some enclosures that they've attached to them, similar to this one here. This is the A255, which I also got, and it's matching controller, but I'm still learning and getting the software going for this guy, and there's a couple of connectors that I still have to build and repair a few things. But this particular one, it was almost identical to the SRS M1A model, so I managed to just figure out the pin connections between the two systems and match them up and made my own custom cables. And as you can see here, I had to rewire the motor connector and the power supply connector for the robot arm from this particular model, which uses an EDAC connector, just an old school connector from the 80s, and essentially making a custom cable so the two robot systems can function together. And so I managed to get this one working, and so I'm still trying to learn the programming behind it, but it's all DOS-based software, so it's pretty old school, but it's pretty amazing. It's so cool. It's really amazing to learn how to